fi yn gofi. Os ta sydd yn nos i ddyn i glopyn ar ffwrt yn y tir y fe ffech yn sir, cwnnes y fi cwrs i ced blin o hyn agos mil blin o hyn. Mae'r helus cyntile clob nef colym cilo chwn de hi roi'n nhw yn tarman mae'r twgdr er. Agos ys cynti, y gawn ced blin, y gawn mil blin ele, beg ddyn y ffech yn sir coma. Agos na chwn ti'n gyholi'n masin, gwmeg ffis teip mae'r eisio her ffoel, nhw rychiwch chi'n na blin ty sin, gwmeg ddyn yn o'n oel yma, cwnnes mae'r fi cwrsi mil blin o ced blin rhywbeth. Denim cogod y cyslesion talman, a socht yn ffis teip sio hwcwr ar ffoel, bwyn i gyd pen y fas, a os ys cynt y gymryd hig dyn yn sy'n y glwm to tal y tap gyffoel. Slan y gyd.
Shades of evening gently fell upon an April day. My mind was held as in a spell, too soon to pass away. A kindred spirit walked with me, while legion stars aglow, looked down with eyes that seemed to say, I know, I know, I know. Their time and space forgotten were, we strolled as in a dream. Our hearts were silent as a prayer. Our joy was so extreme. We spoke of many hopes and fears, and friends forever true, and planned how in the future years we'd bring the past to view. We sang old songs to wandering notes that drifted in the air, as though to lift our thoughts aloft from every selfish care. But too soon the moment sped, and duty brought to mind the thoughts that happiness had wings, and time was so unkind.
The words of Joe McGarrity, arguably the most famous son of the ancient parish of Termonmagurk, encompassing the townlands of Creggan in the north to Gortfinbar in the south, and from Striff in the west to Trumug in the east. Townlands rich in history, tradition and culture, bearing proud Gaelic names like Sulchan, Creggan Conroe, Creggan de Vesky, Grana, Mullionmore, Copney, Creggan, Loch McCrory, Altrumond, Glenupper, Mullionbeg, Achna Greggan, Clare, Sluggan, Ahiogan, Initiative, Athenree, Dunmisk, Tarooney, Tunigan, Eskerboy, Torsala, Leninye and Altanya. The townlands remain the same. The rivers, bogs, lakes and hills bear the same Irish names as they did in the times of our ancestors, who also carried the same names as are prevalent in the modern parish of Termonmagurk. The names have not been the only legacy left to us. A love of traditional music, a pride in our local folklore, and an unshakable awareness of our roots all go together to mould the wider society of which we are all part. It was then to areas like Termonmagurk that at the end of the 19th and in the early years of the 20th century, developments in other parts of Ireland began to filter through in response to a creeping process of Anglicisation which threatened the heritage of areas like our own. Chief amongst these developments was the spread of Gaelic games and the growth of Cumann Lughlas Gael to coordinate this development. What follows in this tip is not a comprehensive study of such development, but rather a series of glimpses at some of the highlights in the story of our own part in the growth of the GAA, through the eyes of a few of the thousands of people down the years who have left us a sporting legacy to be proud of. Club Columkilla, na Carriga Moira.
This book, The History of the GAA in Tyrone, 1884-1984, was written by our very own Joe Martin, an expert on the history of the GAA in Tyrone and further afield. And who better to introduce our Millennium video than our very own son of the parish, Joe Martin.
Joe represents the middle generation of a footballing family. His father, Paddy, was on the first official team against Aher in 1932, pictured here 50 years later with his brother Mickey, Paddy Nugent, Mickey McGork, David McCallan and Paddy McChrystal. His nephew Eamon won juvenile, under 21 and senior championship medals and a string of league medals in the 80s and 90s. Joe begins at the foundation of the GAA to the time it began to make inroads into Tyrone, showing us where Club Columbkille comes into the picture, as well as identifying some of those people who made such an impact in the early years of the club.
But really, it wasn't until well into the early years of this century that it took any hold at all in Tyrone. There was a club in Cookstown in 1890, but apart from that, there's no record at all of any serious GAA activity in Tyrone prior to 1902-1903. There was a lot of GAA activity in Tyrone, east and west, in the period 1906 to 1909, before it died out. And then there was a county board established and competitions took place again 1913-14. But it's quite remarkable that Carrickmore wasn't involved in those. And it wasn't until 1916 when there was a remarkable upsurge in GAA activity in the county that Carrickmore really got involved for the first time. And a club was established at that stage called St. Columbkille's Hurling and Football Club. It's interesting, we know it was called that from a newspaper report, and I think it's significant that hurling was put in first place before football, although in fact there was almost no hurling activity and there's very little record of anything at that stage. The chairman of the club was Mick Rafferty, and he owned the land where the Dean McGurk School is now, and that was where Carrickmore played their games. And the interesting thing was that their jersey was white with green collar and green cuffs and a green band around it. And the lettering, the club, the lettering for the club name was in gold. It's interesting too that when Carrickmore, the St. Presence in Columbkille started in 1932, that their first jerseys were green in colour. And I think it's interesting that the club colours reflect that now. But the GAA really went out of existence in Tyrone around 1920. And from 1920 to 23, there was absolutely nothing taking place. There was a little bit of Parish League, that kind of thing. But it didn't really get started until 1923, after the Troubles. And there's a record of Carrickmore taking part in maybe one or two games at that stage. But really, from then until 1932, nothing happened. When the GAA was established in Tyrone in 1923, it really took hold in East Tyrone. And I would put that down very largely to the influence of a few key people, one of whom would be Mick Coney, who was the secretary for a long period at that stage. In Tyrone, there was a little bit of sporadic activity during the 1920s, particularly in Ballygolly Parish, where Ballygolly would have taken part in the county championship and would have won a county championship. There was a little bit in Berra, a little bit in Omagh, in Aher at times, but almost, there was nothing at all in Carrickmore. There are some records of people taking part in parish leagues, but really it is quite remarkable that in a club which has won 12 championships since 1932, that practically nothing took place during the 1920s. Now, the GAA throughout the country, at national level and at provincial level, was very conscious of the fact that it hadn't established itself. insignificant areas of Ulster. In 1929, strong efforts were made to do something about it, but there's no evidence of any Carrickmore activity. And then it's interesting, in 1931, Cardinal McCrory, who was then the Archbishop of Armagh, he presided at the first of a series of meetings which were held throughout Ulster. This one took place in Armagh, to try and revive the GAA in areas where it hadn't caught on. And a number of priests throughout Ulster and in Tyrone were involved in this. And Father McGilligan at that time, who was a dairyman, was the curate in Carrickmore. And there's no doubt whatsoever that he was one of the people who gave it the push and the impetus which was needed. And in fact, the GAA has continued unbroken since 1932 to the present time in Carrickmore. In 1932, when the present club was established, as St. Colum Caolas Gaelic Football Club, and really has gone from strength to strength since that time.
Joe's father, Paddy, takes up the story of those early days in conversation with Joe Eamon, club chairman Arthur McCallan, and Frank Dilley, another great club servant who played on the three-in-a-row team from 77 to 79.
Two sets of dopes. Mickey James and Paddy, his brother. And the Tones and the Michael Tone and Paddy Tone and all.
And what sort of a team was that, Paddy?
Was a man of class, would
yeah.
you? And it was a bit greenish now for not much practice, you know. You'd be working with horses and things and you go and play on a Sunday. There's no running every other day to train.
Paddy, yourself and your brother Mickey were members of the first Carrickmore team.
Yes.
Can you remember who else played on that team?
Well, you talked about Jimmy Nugent a while ago. He was one of them. Mickey Slaney-Grana, Patsy McWilliams, Mickey McGork, Mickey Nancy. And the Crystals, Frank and Paddy. And there's Pat McCann. And the Tones, Paddy and Paddy and Michael McCallan.
From late until 1999 till today, his grandson, Ozzy, Miller,
and
Plunkett.
That direct line.
He's a present man.
So he's the present goalie. Uh-huh. And David was the first goalie.
David was the first.
It was in 1936 when Carrickmore reached their first final. Joe, your uncles, Jim, Johnny and Mick Nicholduff were members of that team. Could you tell us in there?
Well, and in fact, Johnny and Jim and Mick were all on that first winning team that beat Dungannon in a replay in 1940. And the story is told about Johnny. I think he was standing on the edge of the square and somebody sent him a pass. And it was just an open goal, but the story that Johnny tells is, mind you, I could have missed it. I think if he had missed it, you know, he'd never have come back near Carrickmore. But then Mick and Jim were on the 1943 team that beat the Great Moortown team, who had been county champions at the time. And then Jim was in the 1949 team that beat Gary Tresk in the final. So there was that link through into the 1940s. Then Jim would have played right on, I think, up until about 1956 or so.